skills. Okay, the lady who was just speaking, and wow, what a presentation, what a speech. She was afraid that all the work that she's going to do in the future is going to be compared with this freakishly successful work that she had done. And I'm standing here mortally afraid that as I speak, you'll be comparing me with her. A horrifying thought. As it is, I couldn't figure out why on earth Awab and his friends invited me to speak at this TED, because I have to confess I don't know much about TED, but whatever little I do know about it, TED in my mind is cool people talking about cool stuff. I am a decidedly uncool person, and I'm going to be talking about coal. I mean, for heaven's sakes, that's not even 20th century, that's 18th century. Except that it ain't about coal at all. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'm going to talk to you about, and my wife is here somewhere, but several years before I met her and fell in love with her, I'm going to be talking about my first love in life and still an enduring love, and that's this country and the people of this country, and that's what this is all about. Everybody knows this, okay? GDP per capita less than $1,000. What does that mean? 60%, almost every 2 out of 3 Pakistanis with income less than $2 in a day. Okay. Mortality rate, 1 out of 11 children die before they reach the age 5. Okay, we're not talking about not being able to afford the latest iPod. We're talking about mere ability to survive. That's the degree of the development challenge we face. And in order to meet this challenge, we need what every country in the world needs. And that is energy. Okay? What you see there on the graph is something very simple. It's the energy consumption in a country correlated against its GDP. And as you can see, it pretty much is a linear line. The bigger the economy that you have, the more the energy that is needed to support that. So if you're going to come out of those dire consequences, and trust me, there is nothing romantic about poverty, okay? If you're going to be coming out of that, you're going to need a lot of energy. But where do we stand today? Each and every one of you touches and feels this economic energy shortage on a daily basis. So really, I don't need to talk to you much about it. But still, almost half of Pakistan actually has no electricity connection at all. Okay, so we are the lucky ones. Those who have it, shortfalls of as high as at a peak of 5,000 megawatts, 8 to 16 hours, depending on which city of Pakistan you're at. That's the kind of load shedding you're seeing. Economic impact, colossal. But really, it's the human impact which is the biggest reason why we need to worry about it. But do we have a free hand? Do we have a free choice in selecting where the energy that we need is going to come from? There is no doubt about it. We need that energy. We don't have it right now, so that's easy. But do we have a free choice? What kind of energy? Unfortunately, again, we don't have a choice. What you see here, and you forget about the graph, basically what it says is that Pakistan's resources that we have available, based on all the foreign exchange earnings that we get and all the money that we have to spend on things that we buy, we are constantly short of the resources that we need, okay? Slightly technical, but the economists pretty much all agree that a current account deficit, which is the sum total of all this, 4% of GDP is the max Pakistan can sustain, okay? The rate at which our debt is piling up recently in the last couple of years and growing very, very fast, my humble opinion is to bring it down to manageable level, we have to bring this deficit down to no more than 2%, okay? If you look at our energy import bill right now, that energy import bill is actually more than our the 4% level that we are targeting for. And what you see on the right-hand side is that if I take all the choices available, legit choices available to me, of developing energy from my indigenous resources, I will still be left with a gap where just the incremental energy that I need to import to meet my energy requirements is going to be about 3% of my GDP. Bottom line of all this technical mumbo-jumbo is we simply cannot afford to grow our economy on the basis of imported energy. We just don't have that option. We don't have the finances for that. Every time Pakistan's economy has tried to grow at a rate slightly more than 5%, it's been just 3, 4, 5 years before we get hit by a current account deficit, a depletion of our foreign exchange reserve, IMF walks in, devaluation of currency. We blame it all on IMF, but actually it's got nothing to do with that. It's simply that we don't have the ability to grow on the basis of imported resources. It's as simple as that. So what we are going to talk about today is this field, reasonably close to where we are in the province where we are sitting right now, called Thar. Seventh biggest coal reserve in the world. But what does that mean? 175 billion tons of lignite coal, not great quality coal, but the kind of quality which many countries in the world use. The energy content is equal to 50 billion tons of oil. That, ladies and gentlemen, is more than the combined oil reserves of Saudi Arabia and Iran. It is 68 times bigger than the gas reserves of Pakistan. We are involved in a project which is got 1%. It's called Block 2 of Thar Coal. And that the reserves in that Thar Coal Block 2 are less than 1% of the total reserves of Thar. That 1% of coal is enough to produce 4,000 megawatts of energy, which, if you look at Pakistan today, is more than 25% of our total electricity requirement, just 1%. So 4% of Thar could meet your entire electricity requirements today. That's how massive it is. But affordability is a key issue, not just at a national level, but affordability is also a key issue at an individual level. Okay, it's not working for some reason. But I'll tell you, basically what this says is that while I tried many times, Doc, I told you, like, technology doesn't like me. It works, yes. Okay. Wind is an option. The red bar is what the government of Pakistan says is we're willing to give people who are going to invest in wind energy. It's 9.5 cents per kilowatt hours, and it's been an extremely successful policy, a roaring success, ladies and gentlemen. A cumulative investment equal to 5 megawatts has come in so far. Okay. There is an offer sitting there from a company who I won't name, but it's a well-known foundation of Pakistan. They have requested a tariff of 18 cents for 50 megawatts of wind that they want to generate. RFO, which is pretty much all that we are doing these days, is costing us 17 cents. And it's imported. Thar coal is going to range between 10 and 12 cents. When the project is fully developed, you'll know, but the low end is 10 cents, the high end is 12 cents. LNG, which is the other option which is available to us and which we should be working on right now, but are not, is at current prices going to cost us about 11 cents. So Thar is comparable with that, with LNG, except the Thar is indigenous resource. Remember, we can't afford to import energy. Hydro runoff river is, it shows here at 9 cents. There are a couple of projects which can come on stream at 9 cents, but actually it's very site specific, and some of the tariffs are as high as 15 and 16. But hydro energy is an integral part of the energy mix that we need. It must be developed. Couple of things that you have to keep in mind. Hydro is seasonal. It is not what is called in power jargon base load, because it is not available to you at the same rate throughout the year. So this is going to meet your peaking requirements, but it's not going to be something that you can rely on 12 months in a year. But as I said, critical to develop, and we must develop it. Okay, this is something which I thought would be of interest, because I'm talking about affordability being a key metric when it comes to a poor country. This is Mr. Ken Salazar talking in front of the US Senate hearing, which was recently held. And somebody was asking him about oil and gas, and I guess the BP oil spill was in the background of the discussion. And he says, United States of America, this, ladies and gentlemen, is the biggest economy of the world, close to $15 trillion, $45,000 per capita income. And he says, if we don't use oil and gas, we'll effectively shut down an economy. What he means is, the economy of the US is not going to shut down, but the alternates are expensive. And even the richest country in the world cannot ignore that fact. Okay, I just realized what's going on. I click here, and the click actually doesn't work. Awab bends down and he clicks it forward. So you think technology is working. Well done, Doc. Okay. Just to give you some details of what the project is all about. This is a joint venture with the Sindh government, the coal mining side. The power generation side is going to be done totally in the private sector. The coal mining side is 60% our company, 40% government of Sindh. There's a detailed viability study which is underway right now. And essentially, if you walk into the place where that's going on, it looks like a mini United Nations. We've got Greeks, Germans, Chinese, American, all Japanese, all kinds of nationalities working there, the best available in the world. The first project is going to be, the first phase of the project is 6.5 million tons of coal, 1,200 megawatts of power, should be on stream by 2016. The total when it comes on stream will be 22.5 million tons of coal, 4,000 megawatts of power. First phase, $3 to $4 billion, total of $10 billion. Just to give this some context, ladies and gentlemen, the biggest investment, private sector investment in Pakistan's history was HUBCO. Total investment, which in the end I think panned out to about $1.2-1.3 billion. World Bank supported, Special Energy Development Fund set up, 6 years to close that, $1.2 billion. We're talking $3 to $4 billion in the first phase. Oh, you jumped ahead. Okay. Click one more, I want to see this whole page. Now it's working, yay. Stay on stage, it's scared of you, just like I am. Okay, this is supposed to be with a question mark. Awab has put up the old slide here which doesn't have the question. I'm just asking a question, is it a world of carbon apartheid? What I'm showing here are a few things. China produces 80% of its power from coal. United States produces 50% of its power from coal. India produces 70% of its power from coal. And in terms of the total terawatt hours produced between the three of them, about 5,000 terawatt hours is being produced there. If we develop this 4,000 megawatt of Thar coal, we are talking about approximately 12% of our power generation coming from coal. 12% only. It's obviously it. But you say, yeah, that's the total number, but you are third world countries and Pakistanis, which is like just about as bad as you can get. CNN will tell you that every day. So you must be polluting more. The dirtiest US plants are about twice as dirtier than what Thar coal is going to be. Even the average of the United States and the average of the total OECD are actually more emissions than what you're going to see in Thar coal, and I'm going to talk about later why that is the case. And the world ain't done yet, ladies and gentlemen. Everybody knows about India and China putting up coal-fired plants, 175 of them going on, but more than 40 plants in the OECD under construction today based on coal. And just in case people are wondering why I'm drawing these comparisons, because A, the environment is very close to my heart also. I am also a global citizen of this world. But the World Bank and the US government has taken a position where, without formally announcing it, they're effectively not supporting the development of these reserves on environmental grounds. And that's why I'm giving you all of these comparisons. Doc, more help needed. Just do the whole page. Do one or two more. Two more clicks. Okay, thanks. This is the reality of the environment, why we are still going ahead while understanding that coal is a challenge. Those who are familiar with the debate about global warming would know about the two cases, the 550 ppm, the 450 ppm. That's the lower case, that's the more ambitious case. And if you're able to limit carbon levels in the atmosphere at 450 ppm, you'll be able to restrict, hopefully, the rise of temperature to no more than 2 degrees. And 2 degrees by itself will be hugely disruptive. Okay? So that's not zero disruption case, that's still hugely disruptive, but that's the best the world can expect. For that to happen, the power generation sector has to limit its entire emissions, the carbon emissions, the CO2 emissions to about 9,000, just under 9,000 gigatons of coal. Okay? That's what you were already producing from coal-fired power plants. And you saw on the previous slide the hundreds of new plants which are coming on stream. The world cannot deal with this issue of carbon emissions until it deals with the issue of carbon emissions from coal-fired plants. Okay? Without going into detail, there is advanced level work going on, something called carbon storage and sequestration. The US is working on it. Germany is working on it. I visited the actual site where that work is going on. China is working on it. What we are going to do is we're going to make sure that our technology is CCS enabled. The day commercially available CCS technology is there, we will put it on and we will retrofit onto the plant. We'll do the pre-investments required to make that happen. I truly believe that will happen because the future of humanity is at stake if you're not able to find an answer to that solution. I'm a huge optimist and I believe humanity will find an answer. In the end, I will ask you a question. And this is not a facetious question because it relates to all aspects of Thar Coal, both the environmental, the global dimension of it, and the local dimension of that project. I think in the last couple of centuries, we have become more and more oriented towards rationality. You heard the reference to that in the previous speech also. We're driven by technology, we're driven by economics, but somehow we believe there is no space, or at least there is no space in public life for morality. And I would like to argue that that is just simply wrong. What kind of a world we create and who gets the benefit of that world and who pays the price of those developments is a central question to the kind of world we want to live in. Does this woman and her children have a say or have a right over the resources that we have in this world and in this country, and do they, and she get to benefit from it as much as the company which is going to develop it and the federal and the provincial governments, is a central question. Or are we simply saying we're reconciling to the fact that this world is for the rich and famous only, and that's what we're going to design it for? I'll leave you in the end. My 18 minutes are about to be up. Thank you on your behalf for well done being in 18 minutes, Doc. The most asked question, do you think you will be able to do it? The honest answer is, I don't know. I can't promise you that it will happen, but I will make you a promise. If it does not happen, it will not be because we did not try hard enough.